Darkness is the emblem of ignorance and sin. The verse of Isaiah could not apply to the Israelites because they had already received the Torah. They had a multitude of prophets from God. And more than that, verse 17, which follows from verse 16, quite clearly states, those who trust in idols, who say to images, you are our gods, will return back in utter shame. Now, you can't isolate passages, and I think what many people do, Muslims do the same, Christians do the same, is that they atomize scripture. They atomize scripture and take it out of context. If you look at the entire ambit of Isaiah 42, in particular verse 17, it's quite clear that a special person that God is talking about will be sent to a people who worship idols. And now, in light of what I had said earlier on, that cannot be referring to Jesus, because the Israelites were fundamentally monotheists. They were not idol worshippers. Jesus himself explicitly told the disciples to stay away from idol worshipping Gentiles, the exact opposite of what Isaiah prophesied. And, effectively, you find that when you tie this up, you look at verse 17, you look at verse 16, and you juxtapose it with, I think, the initial verse, which I find and pointed out, you find that you have to twist the scripture to make it seem to suggest that this is a direct reference to Christ or, in fact, the Israelites. It speaks about a new song. It speaks about idolatrous nations. It speaks about the fact that people will be led out of ways along unfamiliar paths. They will lead the blind by ways they have not known. I will guide them. I will turn them into darkness. Now, if this is a prophecy of someone to come in the future, and clearly if it's a reference to the Israelites, then how, by any stretch of an imagination, could one now apply to them where you had a multitude of prophets being sent to the Israelites, up to and including Jesus?
Yeah, I'm kind of marveling at these questions. I mean, you sink your ship.
I mean, these are honest questions, Dr. Brown. I mean, I'm not suggesting anything. I'm just simply asking.
No, I'm just kind of, in other words, I'm astounded. I've dealt, for decades with objections to the text, and just looked at, pure critical scholarly readings of Isaiah 42. And I'm just kind of astounded by some of the statements that are being made. I'm, because you're obviously a studied man. So I'm surprised by statements that you're making. Number one, the larger context of Isaiah 40 through 55 is the Jewish people coming out of exile. And that's often God leading them out of the wilderness and God making a way when there is no way. That's a repeated theme that anyone reading Isaiah 40 through 55 knows. That's number one. Number two, another major theme is that the idols are not gods at all, because the Jewish people who went into exile were guilty of idolatry. And God is now saying it's an end of the time of idolatry. I'm bringing my judgment on that once and for all and leading you out. So the theme of idols is over and over and over in these chapters. Why? Because it was totally relevant to the people that were hearing it. And it was a challenge to the pagan gods as well. That's why God constantly says, I'm going to show you the end from the beginning. I'm going to tell you that the Jews are going to come out of exile. I'm going to show you this work of redemption I'm doing before it happens, so you'll know I am God. But you've got throughout this text, I mean, over and over and over from Isaiah, starting in the 40th chapter and the chapters that follow, references to building idols, references to the people making a tree and bowing down to it. So this context of idolatry was absolutely relevant to those that were coming out of exile and hearing this message. And again, I emphasize that the servant of the Lord that's spoken of, the individual, is one within Israel. He cannot be a foreigner. He is someone within Israel who fulfills the mission and destiny of Israel. That's why you have a lot of overlap. Things that are said of the servant as a nation also refer to the servant individually. As for a new song, that it could mean new law, if God wanted to say new law, he'd say new law. Here's the thing. If God tells Israel, I'm going to send a new law, well, does that mean that everything that he spoke at Sinai no longer applies? That's how you would test a prophet. You would test a prophet by their loyalty to the Sinai covenant. And if they came and taught something different, even if they worked miracles, according to Deuteronomy, the 13th chapter, you were therefore to reject them. So you must come in obedience to the law and the prophets and fulfill what's written. And in doing so, now you bring God's new revelation. Now you bring a new and better covenant. Isn't it Jesus who talks about new wine needs new wine skins? Isn't his message that he has come to establish a new and better covenant but he doesn't do it by destroying what's before. He does it by building on what's before. You can build a new story on a house. You have a two-story house and you're going to build a new story and make it third story. That's a brand new story, but you don't demolish the first and second stories. Otherwise, the third story will collapse. So he brings to fulfillment what's written and establishes God's new and better covenant. And not only so, these verses, sing to the Lord a new song, sing his praise from the ends of the earth. These were spoken in the Psalms. These were spoken throughout Israelite history, because part of Israel's role was to be a light to the nations of the whole world. And this message of the Messiah has gone to the nations of the whole world. And I've been with the Hindus who've thrown away their idols, and the Africans who've thrown away their idols. Through the message of Jesus, there were countless people throwing away their idols before Muhammad was ever born, and they continue to throw away their idols to this day. So I, with all respect, sir, it almost sounds as if there's an agenda in reading the text, because the natural reading of it is so absolutely contrary to the arguments that you're making. So, I mean, I appreciate the time to interact. It's our first time doing so, but I'm kind of playing. I don't mean this in a debating way. I'm plainly baffled by the nature of the questions, because they're so non-contextual and not even faithful, be it Old Testament itself or New Testament itself. So just with all respect, I want to be candid about that.
Has Sam Shimin has asked to make a contribution at this point. Dan, do you want to jump in, Sam?
Well, sure. Dr. Brown?
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
You know, I love you, and I pray by the grace of God that I can reflect your patience and love. So pray for me. I'm still a work in progress. So, but I just want to ask a question, because there's some things that Yusuf Ismail claimed that not only contradict the Bible, contradict his own Quran, but I'll get to that. From a biblical perspective, from the perspective of the Tanakh, could a prophet tell the people, here's the stone, so I want you to repeat after me and bow down and kiss that stone and be acceptable to the God of Abraham?
Oh, certainly not. Over and over, bowing down to wood, bowing down to stones, attributing any deity to something other than God himself. Certainly not, under no circumstances. In fact, the false gods were often ridiculed as being no more than wood and stone.
All right, now, my question is, would that be idolatry if the prophet were to do so? And would he then, if we were living in a theocracy at the time of Moses? Obviously, as Christians, we don't have the power to put anyone to death. But in the time of Moses, under a theocracy, if a prophet did that, would he then be put to death?
If a prophet attributed deity to a stone, or if a prophet said, this is your God, O Israel, then that would have been worthy of a death penalty. If a prophet simply said, kiss a stone in worship of God, that would have been confusing and misleading. Would there have been a death penalty? You could debate that, because we have the death penalty laid out in Deuteronomy 13, saying, let's follow other gods, which your fathers have not known. And then Deuteronomy 18, prophesying something in the name of another god or something that doesn't come to pass. So this would clearly be wrong. Whether it be a death penalty or not would be debatable.
Okay, so the reason why I say that is because part of the sunnah, because the majority of Muslims are Sunni Muslims, and they don't just follow the Quran alone, because the Quran in of itself is incomplete, incoherent, unintelligible. So you have to make recourse to what's called the Sunnah, and that's found in literature such as the Hadith. Muhammad kissed a black stone and would smother it. And this becomes the Sunnah for all his followers to this day, so that when they make a pilgrimage to the Kaaba, they have to also, if they can, kiss the black stone, smother it. And there's an interesting narration attributed to Umar ibn al-Khattab, who was the second caliph. When he went to kiss the black stone after the death of Muhammad, he goes, I know that you're a stone that can neither harm nor benefit. Had I not seen the Messenger of Allah do so, I would not do so. Does that sound like Muhammad eradicated idolatry?
Oh, yeah. I mean, certainly. No argument. The only thing I would say is I would gladly have you represent that point, and then you and Yusuf take that up, just so I stay on. Stay. I'm sure you have, but stay on the point that I'm staying on. But yeah, of course, I agree with you. Look, I was just trying to answer the questions plainly, again, with all respect, as absurd as they were, with each one being asked, I thought, okay, I don't want to be disdainful, because Yusuf's a serious guy and is a studied guy, but they were so self-contradictory in terms of what Scripture actually says. to now come in with other issues regarding Muhammad, of course I agree with your critique. I just want to stay on my appointed focus on this topic, but of course I agree with you.
Well, here, let me then end it this way, unless Yusuf wants to try to chime in. I'll be more than happy to interact with him. What's ironic, Doc, not only did you demonstrate from the very Gospels that he quoted, that if you read those Gospels in context, Jesus doesn't limit his mission to the Israelites, because although he starts with the Israelites, he commissions the apostles and spread the gospel throughout the entire world. And what's ironic, he alluded to Matthew 10, 5 to 6. But in Matthew 10, 17, 18, even in that pericope, Jesus tells them that they'll be brought before the rulers as a testimony to them and the nations. Even in that very chapter,
yes. Irony of irony. You'll be hated by all nations because of it. Exactly. Yeah, there's no possible way to read it and say on any level that this was supposed to be limited to Israel. That was the whole mission. And again, it struck me as very bizarre that when any Quranic scholar knows you have to know when something was allegedly revealed and what's Mecca and what's Medina and what's the order and which comes first and even the verses of violence, no, those only apply to a certain time and they didn't apply to this time, you know, to not read the New Testament, which actually gives you the time. It's actually laid out chronologically where we know what came first and what came second. You know, that Jesus was born here and he taught here and he died here and he rose here. And then he sent the Spirit and the disciples went here and did this. Yeah, again, it's a very strange proof texting. That what bothers me is not that someone raises an argument, but when I always try to refute my argument before I bring it, you know, and if I really think it's good, then I try it out on my wife because she'll knock it down pretty quickly if it's not. So basically, a lot of these arguments I never would have raised because you refute them before you even raise them when you think them through. But yeah, certainly any plain reading of the New Testament sees the message going to the nations, the message going to foreigners, the message going to a Samaritan, you know, to these outliers, the message going to women. That, you know, it's constantly breaking the normal bounds with the message going out. And then, of course, to the nations. So the question is, who brought it to the nations? Jews, Jewish followers of Jesus, who now continue in that mission, extending the mission of the servant of the Lord. Yeah. So thank you. Appreciate it.
I don't want to hog up the time, but I do want to now show you from the Quran for the benefit of the Muslims, because they're going to say our Bible's corrupt. Ironically, the very Quran that Yusuf believes in affirms the universal mission of Jesus. For example, chapter 2, verse 185, this is what it says about the Quran. Ramadan is the month in which was sent down the Quran as a guide to mankind. Nas, a guide to mankind, Nas. Now, let's see what it says about the Torah and the Gospel. Chapter 3 of the Quran, verses 3 and 4. It is he, chapter 3, verses 3 and 4. It is he who sent down to thee, meaning you, Muhammad, in truth the book confirming what is between your hands. He sent down the Torah and the Gospel before this as a guide to mankind, linnas. Just like the Quran is a guide to mankind, the Torah and the Gospel are guides to mankind as well. Now, if you want to limit it to the Israelites, then that means the Quran is only for the Arabs. Nonsense. But here's a couple more. 21:107 of the Quran. Speaking of Muhammad, we sent thee not but as a mercy for all creatures. Al-Amin. We sent you as a mercy for all creatures. Al-Amin. Now, let's see what it says about Jesus. 21:91. Speaking of Jesus and his mother. And remember her who guarded her private part. We breathed into her of our spirit and made her and her son a sign for Israel, for all peoples. Ayatin lil-Alamin. The same universal language used of Muhammad's mission is used of Jesus, so that if someone's going to even be faithful to the Quran, he cannot, with a clear conscience, limit Jesus' mission to Israel, because the Quran doesn't limit it to Israel. It says he went to Israel, but he wasn't for Israel alone. Now, I have hadith references to confirm that, but I'll stop there. Excellent refutation of Yusuf Ismail. Keep it up. We love you, Doc.
Thanks so much. And by the way, you know, I'm more expert in traditional Jewish objections than I am to Islamic objections. And, you know, I've got 3 years of classical Arabic and just keep trying to grow in my knowledge of Islam so I can have more constructive conversation. I think we've had a good amount of discussion on that. Thank you.
That's all, folks.